So I want to thank you guys all for joining us today. This is going to be an exciting presentation on a very exciting printer. You know, the Epson V7000 has been on the market now about two and a half years. And, you know, Grimco has loved this machine since day one. Tell me if I'm wrong on this one, David, but I think we were the first unit outside of your facility to have one in North America. So, like, we've had our hands on this machine for a long time. I'm joined today with David Lopez out in Carson, California. David Lopez is the product manager for the Epson SureColor line, this machine and a couple other phenomenal printers that Epson produces. David, you want a quick introduction to yourself?
Yeah, thanks for kind of giving me a good introduction already, Neil. Yeah, I'm David Lopez. I'm the product manager for anything signage here at Epson for our large format printer division. So anything to do with solvent, a resin, or the UV that we're going to be talking about today. Neil is right. They've actually been one of the first ones to actually have this printer outside of our facility. We moved over to a new facility out in Los Alamitos, California, where we have all of our products here. And you'll be able to see right behind me, we have a bunch of different applications that we've done with the V7000, and we'll be talking a little bit about it today. So looking forward to showing you some cool prints as Neil has some awesome camera angles. And I'll be talking a little bit about you know, the benefits and the different features for the V7000.
All right, awesome. So in addition to us having this printer for a long time and doing some really amazing things and really seeing firsthand what the quality is, Grimco has been the number one reseller of this device out in the actual market, the sign and graphics market, and we've heard nothing but positive feedback from our customers on it. This machine is positioned really well in the market. David's going to kind of jump into it, but there's some 100% fact behind that. Epson doesn't get into a market until they dominate in that market. And this machine is just another in the long line of Epson products that just delivers on what they promise. It's been really incredible product to work with over the short, feels like a long lifespan. So the pandemic time was a little strange, but now it's nice that we're face-to-face. I have tons of customers here in my demo center get to see this firsthand, as well as doing tons of virtual demos with people. I don't think I've introduced myself yet. I'm Neil McNamara. I'm the technician that runs Grimco's demo center in Chicago, where we house one piece of all the hardware and software options that that Grimco walks through. Before we jump into the presentation, just a couple quick housekeeping tips on here. Hopefully everything's set up with the camera angles correctly, but you should be seeing three camera angles. I got my one up in the ceiling here, me live on camera here, as well as David out in California. If you have questions, please drop them down in the chat or the Q&A. Chris, where do you want the questions to go, chat or Q&A?
Q&A is a little better because we can mark them as answered when they're done, but we'll take them any way you can send them.
Okay, awesome. You know, and that's the benefit. You guys tuned in for this live presentation. We have Chris Cohen, who's in charge of our internet marketing and the hardware sales side of things. You guys tune in for this live presentation. Ask those specific questions that you want. Chris has been given full rein to interrupt me and David here and ask the questions you guys hit us up with live. If not, we'll definitely answer your questions on the back end too. So if there's something really pointed that you've been meaning to ask about this printer, now's your chance. Live webinar. We are going to edit this video down and post it to Grimco's YouTube channel, so you always have the option of watching it again, but you don't have the option of asking the question, so please hit us up with that. All right, well, without any further ado, let's jump into it. David, what do you say?
All right, perfect. Let me go ahead and get my presentation up. And
while you're doing that, I'm going to pull this sheet off the printer and get another one going.
All right, great. Can you see my presentation, Neil?
Yep, looks good.
All right, perfect. So today we're going to be talking about the SureColor V7000. This is a 4x8 UV flatbed printer. We're going to talk about the different features that's with this printer. So this printer kind of sets us apart. We actually have now grown from being very new into the market with a flatbed printer. This is our first UV flatbed printer for Epson to now the best-selling entry-level UV flatbed printer 4x8 in North America right now. So it's been a huge accomplishment. And the reason for that is some of the features that we're gonna be talking about today. So first and foremost, a 10-color ink set. You really don't see that with a flatbed at this price. This is under $100,000. And you're gonna get CMYK, gray, light cyan, light magenta, red, varnish, and white. So that's something a little bit different. We do have a max print head height of 3 inches. It's actually slightly a little bit bigger, 3.14. This does have our Epson printhead technology with our variable ink droplet technology. And this does get bundled in with our Epson EdgePrint RIP software. Now, for those of you who are using a different RIP software right now, maybe using an Onyx, using just any other manufacturer, we work really well with the other manufacturers, and they already have drivers for it. So Onyx has been tried and proven with this. We've tried EFI Fire. We've tried all the different rim manufacturers that are out there, and there are drivers for it. So with this, we are the only 4x8 UV flatbed under that $200,000 mark that has red ink in it. So typically you'll see a more expensive machine, like maybe, I don't know, there's other manufacturers out there that are more of that $200,000 range, even really over $150,000 that possibly might have other spot colors. We are well underneath that $100,000 mark, and we have that special red ink. We saw that with our S series line, our solvent line, we had we have red in our S8600, SureColor S8600, and it extended that color gamut. So what we wanted to do was to bring that same mentality over to our UV flatbed printer. It does have a nice opaque white, and even at the production speeds, the reason for that is because we have 8 printheads in here, and we get a little bit more into it down the slide, but 8 printheads here, and 2 of them are dedicated to that white ink. So that white ink is very opaque, and it does the job that we wanted to do. One thing I do like to talk about is Epson quality. If it's one thing we're known for here at Epson, is our Epson quality. So we haven't gone shy of that. Our printhead technology is in this printer. Our ink chemistry is in this printer. We're very vertically integrated. Well, from top to bottom, we design this and we engineer this to try to work and maintain that Epson quality. And we really wanted to change the image quality expectations you get from a UV flatbed printer. Now, when you think of an entry-level flatbed printer, you know, when this first came out, everybody was just excited to print directly to a rigid substrate. Before, maybe you're printing to a vinyl, attaching it to a board, and it was a multi-step process. So everybody was just excited about printing direct. Quality concerns weren't the highest because they're just happy to go direct. What we wanted to do is, okay, the technology's been out here. How can we change the image quality expectations? So we added that red, added our printhead technology to really focus on that quality.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, David, that slide right back there is the number one sticking point for me with this machine that makes it so incredible. Anytime you're using a flatbed printer, the reason you're doing it is to save labor. You know, you want to save that labor of printing to a self at ease and then having to go through that mounting process by direct printing. You know, you're saving labor. You're saving a little bit of material by not having to use that self adhesive vinyl. But every flatbed printer out there, you're sacrificing that quality. You know, it's giving up that quality, either whether color gamut or that the way it looks. You know, UV prints traditionally in the market have always been that you could tell it was printed on a UV printer because you see that banding, that banding so much as a step and repeat pattern. Kind of looks like a well-manicured lawn, that lawnmower effect. And what I'm printing right now on my machine is the high-speed mode. And I mean, even viewed 6 inches from your face, this image looks incredible. You know, solid colors, bright reds, vibrant print. You'd be hard pressed to tell what direction that printhead carriage was moving while it was printing, because you don't see that kind of lawnmower effect of ink being stacked on top of one another. And that's what the Epson V has really, really set itself apart with.
That high speed mode is impressive. One other thing I'd like to note to that is that a lot of times when you're printing high speed mode, the density of the ink tends to be reduced a little bit. And if you notice with our V7000, the high speed mode still maintains that density of ink, which is quite impressive.
But yeah, that is the high speed mode. And so high speed mode, what is that 4x8 board? How many are you getting per hour?
You're looking at about 15 4x8 boards per hour.
That labor savings of direct printing, but not sacrificing quality and still maintaining that really high speed output.
Gives us a good chance to jump in. Our first question, while we're comparing it to vinyl printers, roll-to-roll printers, what's the expected durability? Can you guys talk about that real quick?
Yeah, great question. So Epson, we've done some testing, and what we've seen is for light fastness, outdoor durability without lamination, you're looking at anywhere between 3 to 5 years, depending on where you're at in the world. So if I'm in Arizona, 104 degree sun hitting right at it, you're looking about right at that three-year mark. If I'm in a more controlled area or environment's a little bit different, we can say 5 years. So it's within that 3 to 5 years. Now, when you laminate, depending on what kind of laminate and what specs it has, that can last. I've seen stuff lasts up to 10 years. What's been your experience, Neil?
Lamination is always the best way. Anytime you're producing long-term outdoor signage, you know, applying a film lamination is 100% the way to go. It all depends on what your expectations are for the end product. Applying a film lamination is 100% the way to go. The problem with unlaminated graphics in the wilderness is it's generally your red channels, you know, your bright colors that tend to fade quicker. And the fact that this is printing with a dedicated red, you're getting an already brighter red out the box. It's going to be a longer lasting sign, longer lasting print in the outdoors because of that red channel.
So this slide we have up in front of us, this is kind of just showing our printhead technology. Now, this printhead we've developed some time ago, but the reason why we went with this is because it was so durable and industrial. We needed a printhead that was going to withstand some of the environments it was going to be in and make sure that it was rugged and reliable, because there are 8 printheads in here, 4 dedicated to the color, 2 dedicated to white, and 2 dedicated to the varnish. And the reason why we went with 8 printheads is, and which I think is kind of amazing how we did this, is we are able to print white, color, and varnish all on a single print. So right now, some other printers out there would have to print white first, then comes back and then prints the color, and then comes back and then would have to print a varnish. We're able to do that all in one shot, so you pick up your production speeds when doing multi-layer. Because this can print to wood, acrylics, all different types of substrates, using that white is definitely something usable and good to have on a printer. Our printheads go down to 3.5 picoliters. And so this really helps with high-end quality images, so smooth gradations. And also, because we can get a perfectly precise dot, we're actually using a little bit of less ink because we're able to get those colors that we need precisely with the mix of all of our colors. I think I jumped right on top of you, Neil. Were you going to say something?
That fact that, hey, you got those dedicated printheads for varnish, you have those dedicated printheads for white, so it does not affect your speed. But you're also not limited in how you want to print. So the arrangement of them, it is the white printheads are all the way in the back. My color print channels are in the middle, and then my varnish is up front. And I can quickly, easily change the order in which the machine prints. So right now I'm printing from front to back. I'm only printing color. I'm printing on a white substrate, so there's no point in using white ink. This file does not have varnish on it. I do have a file prepared next that has varnish prepared for it. But I can change the sequence that I want to print. So if I'm doing a second surface acrylic where I want to lay down color first, white second, simple matter of changing a button section in the flatbed controller to change the order in which the printhead carriage moves, front to back versus back to front. And it lets me use those channels nice and easy. The versatility of quickly being able to move the direction of what you're going to print.
Yep. And just how Neil was talking about, you can see the diagram here on my screen that shows the white printheads are in the back of the carriage. The 4 are in the middle. So we have CMYK on the left side, the gray, red, and light colors on the right side, and then the 2 varnish in the front. Like Neil was saying, if I'm just printing with color only, I can tell it to start from the front, or I can tell it to start from the back, which is a nice process you can do when creating your workflow. So let's talk a little bit about the speed. So this is what we're talking about earlier when it comes to printing 3 layers versus printing 1 layer. This is where I think where we really separate ourselves from some of the other entry-level UV flatbeds out there. So the dark color bar is showing 1 layer. The light color blue bar is showing the 3 layers. So you're going to see that there's a small difference in speed compared to some of the other printers out there that lose 50% productivity when printing multi-layer. So that's where we're really going to shine right there when we're going to speeds. Now, that high speed mode is typically color only looking about 460 square feet an hour. If you do the math, it's about 15 boards per hour. And we've actually done live tests with a stopwatch to make sure that we tested that. Typically, it depends on what you're printing on, just like every other printer. If I'm printing on a corrugated plastic, a yard sign, I can be printing this high speed stuff all day. Quality is going to be sufficient. Now, if I'm, let's say, printing a reverse acrylic or reverse print acrylic of a nice photographic image, I'm probably going to want to slow it down to that quality mode. I know that high speed's about 15 boards an hour, speed's about 8 boards an hour. Production starts to drop down to about 5.5 to 6 boards an hour, and then 3 boards an hour, and then high quality is about a couple boards an hour. And it really depends on what you're looking for. We have people who have this printer that's printing really high-end photography. You know, the price of the photography that they're doing warrants it, so they're okay going slower. And there's some people that are just like what Neil's printing today, just going high speed, and it's good for them.
Some of the, you know, you think about signage, it's generally viewed at distance signage. It's not 6 inches from your nose kind of quality. And all of those, the speed and the high speed modes definitely fit the bill. But if you want, you know, because when your customer picks up his signs or picks up his order for the first time, they are going to hold it 6 inches from their nose. And so, yeah, that production speed, when you see the resolutions there, that puts us at 720 by 720. By slowing down the speed of that printhead carriage movement, that makes that bidirectional, that drop of that small text look nice and smooth. So that production or quality speed looks really amazing.
Here we're talking a little bit about the Ultra Chrome UV ink. So this does come in 1 liter bottles. And this is Epson developed ink. Now, a lot of the times people say, you know what, you guys are kind of new into the UV space. How do I know that you guys got this all dialed down? And really the answer to that is, this is not the first time in the UV space. It's the first time in the large format or in a flatbed. But we've been running UV ink in our SurePress line. We have these giant, you know, $500,000 label presses that use UV and resin ink. So we've been experimenting, and we've kind of got that down from that technology. What we did was we grabbed that ink chemistry and then made it work for the flatbed that you see here today with the SureColor V7000. But it's something that it's tried and tested and been in production or been engineered and studied for the past 10 years, really. One nice thing is that the colors and the white and the varnish are all the same price. I know that on some of for instance, our SureColor S80, the white ink might be a little bit more expensive. What we did for this, because we understand that white is commonly used, we're able to make it all the same price. So MSRP is about $150 a bottle.
Which makes it really easy on me, because people are constantly asking is what is the cost per milliliter? So being $150 for a 1 liter bottle, it's 15 cents a milliliter. So I don't have to do mental gymnastics to figure out cost per milliliter. Makes it really easy. And the fact that, yeah, it's the same for all the varnish, the white, the color, it's all the same cost. Well, we got this here. David, you might stop your screen share for just a second. I want to show the difference between varnish and non-varnish. I have these two images here. One was printed with varnish. Oh, that looks so much better. So the one on my right hand, there's exact same file, no varnish applied to this. Good looking print, you know, amazing little ladybugs on there, nice little swirl pattern. Really looks cool. But then this is the exact same file with a varnish layer applied. And you could see how much that just pops and catches the eye. You know, the reason we put signage out in the world is to draw attention to it and really promote a product, promote a brand. And this is what that varnish can do for you. You know, kind of nice looking sign, great image quality, looks pretty and all, really nice looking text. But then that varnish is going to catch somebody's eye and really kind of accentuate. Oh, there you go. Nice lipsticks.
Yeah, this is another example of the varnish doing some kind of effect to draw the eye.
So and again, these, with or without varnish, you're not slowing your machine down to print. You know, it's one of those things like, I don't like having that varnish in there because it eats up channel space or eats up printhead space. Having dedicated printheads for running that varnish, the machine is still just as fast, even when you're running jobs without the varnish or with the varnish. You know, the only thing I have noticed is the printhead carriage does need to travel a little further back when you're using that varnish channel. I'm printing forward to back because my color channels are in the middle, my varnish is behind. Because those lights have to cure and flash, it needs to do maybe 4 extra passes once it's finished printing it. But that's really that's where you get that nominal speed difference using the varnish or not. But yeah, definitely eye-popping signage.
All right, so back to this presentation. We are Green Guard Gold certified. And as a matter of fact, we just got in our new certifications today. Every year, we have to get recertified our inks. So we just got our recent ones for this year. And we are Green Guard Gold certified again. And which this really means that these prints can be up at schools, it can be up at hospitals, and the amount of VOCs that go into the air was below the threshold that the federal government says, so we're able to actually achieve this and get these certifications, which is also good to not limit you to certain places where you can have your prints. We are worldwide certified with all the different certifications. So the AGBV in Germany, French VOCs, pretty much those are the major standards. If you're able to pass those, you can pretty much be passed throughout the whole world. And we are, have met all the requirements for that.
Another question that came in live while we, you guys were showing off the varnishes, does the varnish act in any way like a lamination, or does it extend the life of the color?
It doesn't have any kind of UV inhibitors. It's not going to protect it. It won't act like a lamination. It's more for to give a, you know, some kind of an edge or just catch attention on the print. We have noticed that if you add small amounts of varnish, it makes the color pop more, just to make, you know, the effect really more. It's not a lamination or protection. There's slight protection to, on like scratch and rub resistant. Also, when you add more varnish, your ink flexibility tends to go down a little bit. So it's a give and take there.
And that, the sample that I'm holding up to the camera right now, we do, that's why we set it up this way, is different opacities or different levels of varnish. You know, I could go as small as 10% all the way around this wheel here, and you get a different look. I have found that generally above about a 70% opacity, you're splitting hairs to see the difference, 80, 90, 100. But yeah, you can go, you know, just add a little bit of sheen, add a transparency on there, whereas you go up that scale, you get a little more light showing through there. So definitely a viable, really cool option to play with, but yeah, no additional UV protection. Hey, David, tell me if this is something you've noticed. I've tried it on a bunch of different substrates. The varnish really needs to stick to ink. I cannot just print varnish straight onto a piece of foam board or PVC. Have you experienced that as well?
Yeah, you know what? The varnish, I have printed it like directly to more of a, I believe it was like a PVC. Or it was some type of acrylic. It was a little bit thicker. I was actually playing around with trying to see how much I can raise the ink. And it did tend to work. But I did notice that the varnish tends to soak up a little bit more because the viscosity is a little bit thinner, and it does soak up into materials a little bit differently.
Yeah, yeah. I don't want to use the word coalescing, but it seemed like the varnish was definitely attracted to the ink, to where you try to print varnish on its own, it doesn't kind of lay like the ink would lay. I was trying to do some... printing on a matte self-adhesive, a black matte self-adhesive vinyl, and I was trying to just put clear varnish on top, no color whatsoever, and it didn't give me the nice results I was looking for. Laid down a little bit of ink as an underbase, and then the varnish on top there, it looked amazing. Gave me the result I was looking for.
Yeah, interesting. I wonder if you would have to profile specifically for that, maybe reduce the amount of varnish going down, because it does tend to, when you're just doing it, it tends to spread a little bit more. So it'd be something to be cool to play around with, and might have to figure out.
And I'll tell you, that is, speaking of varnish, it is a designer's dream, you know, to have a printer that has that capability of doing some really neat things, because it's a spot channel. You know, it will never mix varnish in with your regular colors if you're just using your rips off, or you're doing a flood fill or an image fill. But a designer with the right eye for what this image, what this ink set can do for you, can really do some amazing things. So left to my devices, I could design stick figures. You know, that's about as good as I am with design. But Heather here in my demo center has a real eye for it, and she loves some of the neat things we can do with the varnish in here. So it definitely is a designer's dream to have that tool in your toolbox.
So this kind of brings us into our next slide here, and the ink characteristics. So when it comes to ink flexibility, it has 265% for color and white, and varnish is 165%, so a little bit lower. And the scratch and rub resistance, we've done all the different ISO standards, and we've done all the tests, and it's gotten an A or B in the ISO standards for the cross cut and adhesion tests, the scratch and rub resistance. And like I said, the results do improve slightly when you have a varnish coat as far as scratch and rub resistance. But that's about it. It's not going to have any kind of like UV inhibitors. So you can see I got a piece of corrugated plastic and I bend it right in half. And what I'm looking for is the ink cracking, is the what kind of results I'm getting. And being able to bend that 180 is very important. Now, one of the things that's also important is the scratch and rub resistance. And also what I'm doing here is I'm actually cutting right into a corrugated piece of plastic. Again, what I'm looking for is ink chipping, ink, how it's reacting to it. So this is right after we printed straight to it. and it was producing great results, telling me that everything is, you know, the scratch and rub resistance from the blade going into it is doing right. And then we also have the ISO 2409 crosscut test kit, where I did the cross hatches with the tool provided. And they also have a special 3M tape that they use for this test. And it was passing with an A or a B. So it does pass all the standards there.
For those of you at home that started a stopwatch when I started printing this print, so I'm running this at the production mode. So this is that middle of the road production speed where you're at 720 by 720 resolution, but you're going to get amazing quality out of your text. You know, so this is 6 inches from your nose kind of quality speed that I'm printing at here. Obviously, there are higher quality modes above this one, but I found that this production mode is kind of my sweet spot for good balance between speed and awesome quality. I did that for two reasons, because I'm running the varnish on here. I want that to look really nice, and it has fairly small text. You know, we have a Grimco logo as well as some other text on these images here, and I want it to look good 6 inches from my nose. So you can go ahead and stop your stopwatch as soon as the printhead carriage stops moving.
All right. So one of the things that we've done really well was the white ink recirculation, or circulation inside the system. So the circulation actually goes every 30 minutes. And this really helps with any kind of sedimentation that's actually happening that can happen with white ink. Now, this doesn't matter whether it's UV ink, whether it's solvent ink, DTG ink, you name it, because of the chemistry of white ink, it tends to separate a little bit. So what we've done here is we've added the white recirculation system. Now, this works extremely well for printers. Funny little story is I actually have serial number one. So the very first V7000 ever made in the world, and it's here in my facility. And when I first got it, they told me, try to break it. And you know, I've been playing around with I've been playing around with flatbed printers for some time now. So I said, easy. I turn off the printer. I said, I'll be back in a couple of weeks. I guarantee you I'm gonna turn this on, print, I'm gonna check the white nozzles, and unfortunately, probably gonna have to replace some heads. And I said, okay. So I did that exact same thing. And because that white recirculation was going on every 30 minutes, also, let me step back. I did do the soft power off, not the full power off. So the white recirculation was still running. But I checked it after a couple of weeks, ran my nozzle check. My white was completely perfect, which shocked me. It really did shock me. So that was telling me that white recirculation was doing exactly what it needed to do. And it really, really helped out preserve the nozzle integrity, preserve the print heads, and really, it speaks to the reliability and consistency of what you can do with this printer.
One of the questions I get asked most from customers is the maintenance regime or the maintenance schedule on this machine. And if you're printing on this machine, you're doing a heck of a lot less maintenance. You know, it wants to pump that ink and have that ink flowing through those print heads. And they're at the same time, you leave it sit for a week, a day, a couple of days. You know, it's do a quick nozzle check. Everybody's there. Start printing. You're good to go. It's a fully manual maintenance system. There is no automation of the maintenance and cleaning of the printheads in here, but they're Epson printhead technology. So they're designed to jet this Epson ink that's in here. The two things were designed to work together and reduces your maintenance, increases your uptime, makes it a very reliable printer.
Yeah, that's one thing that we really were trying to focus on is have that reliability. When it comes to the maintenance is fairly easy. Like Neil said, it is a manual process where you purge a little bit of ink outside of the printheads. You wipe them manually with a lint-free cloth. I can do it under a couple of minutes. If you're brand new and you're really walking through every step, it's still going to take you under 5 minutes. It's a pretty easy system to run. And for the most part, here in our demo facility in California, you know, I probably don't print as much as an actual sign shop, but still, I only do that head manual maintenance or the manual maintenance probably about once a week. Usually the weekend we don't work here. So Monday morning, we'll check it out, check the nozzles, do a cleaning just to get everything perfect. So, and it's been really good for us. I've had this printer here now for over 3 years. All right. So let's talk a little bit about the usability features. So we do have a pin registration system. It is a manual registration system, meaning I have to have a screwdriver to pop this up. Someone actually on live on a webinar said, how long does it take? And I said, oh, it's pretty quick. So they got a stopwatch and they timed me. They watched me do it. And it took about 5 seconds to get all these up. So it is a fairly fast thing to do. We do have a multi-zone vacuum system, which was really nice. It's broken up into a quadrant. So you have four different zones. And this is nice for if you are not printing on a 4x8 sheet, you are printing a smaller thing. Remember, our head height is 3.14 inches thick. So maybe you're printing on a couple different tumblers or whatever the case may be that you have a jig for. You can dedicate it to that zone, turn off all the other zones to maximize that vacuum.
And again, it's a manual vacuum system. It doesn't know whether I have a 4x8 or a 24x18 on here. I am the one that's controlling those zones on and off. And to me, it's Occam's razor. One less controller inside here to go wrong. If I want to go back to 24/18s, I just close my zones manually with a couple of valves on the side of the machine. Real easy to set up.
Yeah. It's very intuitive, very easy. It's just like Neil said, there's an actual image of where the zone would be. There's a lever, you up or down is closed or open. It's very simple.
Keep it simple.
We do have an auto thickness sensor. So basically it's a mechanical pin that you would tell it coordinates on the table. Now on the table, there is an engraved ruler in there and you would tell it the measurement where you want to pick to the highest point, and then it would measure that. Now, for instance, let's say you like to use a digital caliper and you know that, or you measure it and you have the thickness on your own, you can actually go into the software and do that as well. So you can do it both ways. You can do it with the auto thickness sensor check, or you can do it manually and input that information.
Now, David, I've been printing the same material over and over again, so I haven't gone through that auto measure process. You think it'd be valuable to show that section?
Yeah.
Live on camera? Why not, right?
Yeah, why not?
All right. Yeah, we got a minute. It literally just takes a minute. So I got my vacuum engaged, turned it on. So let's imagine a world where I was switching material. So I'm going to throw it on a sheet of max metal on here where it's a different thickness than the foam board that I have been running. Let's say I wanted to print MDO. You know, MDO is notoriously not straight. I could look here and look for any high spots in my material. And like David was saying, just find my X and Y coordinates and touch off on that high spot. Max metal is a pretty straight board, so I wouldn't need to worry about that so much. I just go over to my flatbed controller and I tell it to execute the measurement process. And so what's going to happen is my print head carriage is going to move to that designated XY coordinate here. And on the underside of the print head carriage, there's a little button that drops out, and it's going to touch off and then give me my exact measurement. So I'm not having to sit here with my caliper and go through anything at all. Just have the measurement process happens automatically.
We did have another question come in when you guys were talking about the print heads. Is there a cost on replacement heads, and how does that process work?
Great question. So when you purchase this, and then you'll talk to Grimco, but we do have warranties that are stackable up to 5 years. Now under warranty, all the print heads are covered. Now, if you are outside of warranty, there is a cost for the printhead and the labor. And if you are, which it's a little bit down the road on my presentation, but if you are signed in or have an account with Epson Cloud Solution Port completely free, you actually get the printhead discounted by 50%. And the cost, it's roughly around $1,200 per printhead. Don't quote me on that because I don't know the exact on it right now, but it's going to be somewhere around that. But we always recommend that you stick to getting the warranties because all the printheads will be covered.
Actually, I want to throw a small disclaimer against everything we said because we have a lot of, Grimco is in three nations. We're in the UK, Canada, and the US here. Prices may vary based on where your location is. So again, reach out to your hardware sales rep with Grimco, and we can get all those details hammered out. That's what we do. That's what Grimco does as the reseller of the Epson product here, is we make sure you fully know everything that's involved in this, and it's not just a quick little webinar presentation because specific cases vary. But yeah, reach out to us, and we can definitely dig into all of that.
Another question that came in real quick too is, what's the substrate size? What's the smallest size that you can print and be held down by the vacuum for reliable printing?
Pretty darn small. It's just a matter of masking off. So you have those four different zones. They're basically 2-foot by 4-foot zones, you know, to give you that full 4x8 bed. So if I had something really small, say a dog tag, you know, a little small thing that I was going to print on there, I would just mask out the surrounding area, you know, fill up the rest of that 2-foot by 4-foot with a substrate that was thinner than what I was trying to print on. And yeah, you can get really, really small with it.
Yeah, for the most part, like when we're doing a sample that's pretty small, we have some regular, you know, home use printer paper that I cover, I mask up the rest of the zone with, and it works perfectly fine.
But we work in large format print, Chris. Large format.
All right, let me get back to the presentation. All right, so this does get bundled in with our Epson Edge Print Pro. If you are using, which for the most part, if you're using any kind of ancillary equipment like a router or cutter or something else that's going to be paired with the SureColor V7000, you're probably going to go with a different RIP software that Grimco provides, or not, I'm sorry, provides, they sell for a different price, but the printer does come with this. Now, for the most part, every time I've done samples, it's been done with Epson Edge Print Pro, and it's done perfectly fine. What I like about this is I always tell people, keep it in the back in case something happens, a computer dies, something blows up on the computer, and you need to absolutely get something out, you probably can do it with this. The color management it's decent. Everything is pretty easy to use. I always tell people, for someone who's never really even printed, I can teach them how to use Epson Edge Print Pro and send a print out in about 30 minutes, which is, it's pretty user-friendly. It's kind of, you know, it's reliable. It does have an ink cost estimation tool onto it. So one of the upgrades that we just did, or the firmware or software updates that we did to it, on the information tab, it will give you a pretty accurate ink cost estimation. Because we understand the printing technology and we have all the proprietary information, it gives a really good ink cost estimation on there, which is nice for the SureColor V7000. So there is a lot of different cool features on there, Adobe PostScript 3, and you can do some tiling, spot color matching, custom color library support. We do still have all the Pantone color libraries on there. And we launched a new little product called the SD10. It's a little.
I was hoping you were going to talk about it, David. So I love that SD10.
Yeah, that SD10 is pretty cool. It's a small little spectrophotometer which reads in colors right away.
The SD10 allows you to do is take your eyeballs out of the equation. You know, when you're trying to manage color or see a color or make sure you're printing Pantone accurate, the SD10 is a light reading or a color reading device that puts numerical values to light. You know, if I'm looking at something now, when I'm seeing color, what I'm seeing is the light hitting the color, bouncing back to my eyeballs. The SD10 does that reading for it. It's got its own internal light. Look, fire away. That's awesome. We scan it, light beam bounces off that color and gives me an actual lab value, RGB value, as well as equivalent Pantone value. So when I'm doing a branded campaign for Starbucks or some other big, Home Depot, I can know what color my device is outputting, as well as, you know, where my printer is at. It allows me to quickly get to adjusting color. Rather than me looking at 50 shades of gray and trying to decide on a color, that spectrophotometer helps me dial in my color processing a lot quicker and easier. And that integrates with Edge Print software, right, David?
Yeah, and that's kind of where I was going with that one. It's small enough, you can keep that into your pocket. It's also really cool because there's an app that goes to your cell phone, so it's all Bluetooth or Wi-Fi connected, and you can see all those different colors match between two things. Like Neil was saying, if you have that Starbucks green that you're trying to hit, and then your printer is producing something else, it'll give you a lab value, it'll give you a CMYK value, and you can do an automatic color adjustment on the software to make sure you're hitting those right greens or whatever the case may be. Really cool little device, and you can get some more information on our website or talk to your.
I feel like we could have done we could have done a whole webinar on the SD10. And I both love that device so much. We could have, but it's a BOGO. For those of you who tuned in, you're getting a bonus on that one.
All right, let's go ahead and get back to the presentation. All right, here's a little bit about that Epson Cloud Solution port. It is a monitoring system that we have out here. Again, completely free. Even if you have an existing Epson product, let's say a SureColor S80, a Shirk or any kind of S series line, the R series resin printers, any of the F series printers, you can, or DTG printers, pretty much anything in a large format lineup, you can sign up, you put your serial number in, you create a Epson Cloud Solution port ID, and you can monitor, you can see cost, you can see cost per job. We do regular updates on this, so we are really adding to this. We have spent a lot of time trying to engineer this and get this as useful as we can for our end users. So give it a check. I have it connected to my Apple Watch. I have it on my cell phone. If an error happens, well, let's say I'm in a meeting and I have a printer running, something happens, runs out of ink, it comes to my Apple Watch. I know what to look for. This is great for production managers. This is great for anybody who wants to see a great overview of all your printers. What's also nice, which kind of ties into the V7000, is this is communicating. So let's say something happens. Now, the goal of this is if something happens, you call in support, our technicians will ask you, do we have permission to see what's going on in your printer? You say yes, then they can remotely go into the printer, see all of the error codes. So when they go out to try to fix something, they're not there having to assess the problem. They already have a good idea of what's going on and they can fix it a whole lot faster. The whole goal behind this is to make sure that you're up and running as fast as possible. We understand things are happening. These are machines. Anything can happen, but it really comes down to how fast can we get you guys up and going and making sure we're maintaining that production for your printers. Like I always say, if you're not printing, you're not making money. So we always want to make sure that you're up and doing and printing. This is my last slide. And this has been a great conversation between me and Neil and I, and hopefully you're getting a lot out of it. But really, this is the main things that I hope you get out of this presentation. Why Epson? Why the SureColor V7000? And when it really comes down to it, it's these three things that we like to focus on. High quality. We've done a really good job by adding this 10-color ink set. We have that white varnish red, which really makes us stand apart. That gray that is everybody's hard to hit color. Try to get some nice grays. We add that in there, the light colors, and of course the CMYK. So 10-color ink system for that high quality. And productivity. We were able to put 8 print heads in this printer and still have it under $100,000. And we're not talking 99,999. We're talking, you know, MSRPs at 83,000. Again, talk to your hardware sales rep at Grimco to see the exact pricing there. But that's what we're looking at. We're able to get 8 print heads in there. And this is for productivity. We wanted to make sure that we're able to print white color varnish and not sacrifice any of that speed and still have that entry level price. So all this kind of ties into it. These are the things that we're thinking about: quality, productivity, and still making it a very competitive price to have in there and have a new addition to your print shop.
David, I cannot thank you enough. This presentation webinar today, hopefully it definitely shed some light and let people know why you and I are so excited about this printer and why the customers who've experienced it are so excited about it, because it definitely delivers on the Epson promise of, you know, reliability and amazing print quality again and again. You guys just keep knocking out of the park with every printer you build. So if you guys want to hear more about this printer or see it face-to-face, whether you come here to my facility or we log in through a webinar one-on-one presentation for you, send an email to hssales@grimco.com, and one of our HS hardware representatives will get back to you, and we'll set something up so you can really get the very specific questions you want to see. They can also set you up with any of the samples. You know, I have tons of samples here that I've printed on this V7000. Really amazing. Here's another amazing max metal print with that eye-catching varnish layer printed on it. So definitely hit us up. We'd love to further this conversation along. Hope we've definitely wet your whistle, though, to see some of the exciting stuff that this Epson V can do for you. Real quick, shameless plug. This exact same time next week, I am going to be traveling out to Carson, California. I get to hang out with my man, David Lopez, face to face. But we're really excited. Epson just announced the release of another brand new printer. Again, this is a market that Epson has dominated for years now. It's the brand new Epson 2270. It's their hybrid machine, direct to garment, as well as direct to film transfer printing machine. So this is in the decorated apparel market. 2270 is the brand new printer. The 2100 is their current market leader. And so now Epson just is one-upping themselves when they come to producing printers. Now they can't, nobody else can hold a candle to them. So now they got to outdo themselves when it comes to making printers. So this time next week, 12 o'clock Central Time, I'll be out in California. We're going to do another live webinar presentation on the 2270. So those of you, take a look at grimco.com. You should be seeing your emails. Sign up for that webinar as well. I'm going to be meeting now with David. Paul Morales is the product manager for the DTG world.
Yep, I'll be Paul Morales and maybe Tim Check.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, so those gentlemen, we're going to hop on camera and tell you all about the awesome, exciting things with the 2270. So same bat time, same bat channel. Tune in. It's going to be a great presentation. Chris, you got anything else for us before we wrap up?
No, just again, just stress, if you guys want to see more, just let us know. hssales@grimco.com.
All right, awesome. I want to thank you guys all for joining us. I love doing these webinar presentations. I hope we brought some value to you. Hope you enjoyed it. And thanks for watching. We'll see you guys later.
See ya.